mighty and everlasting God, we remember before you today your servant coming. And we pray that open to her the gates of larger life. You will receive her more and more into your joyful service. That with all who have served you in the past, she may share in the eternal victory of Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Psalm 46.
Keeping her that long, and because she had have impacted a lot of people in here today. So once more, I thank you, Jesus, for allowing my grandmother to live for 9 years. Amen. The lesson is now taken from John chapter 5, verse 24 to 27. I tell you the truth, whoever hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life and will not be condemned. He has crossed over from death to life. I tell you the truth, a time is coming and has now come when the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God, and those who hear will live. For as the Father has eternal life in himself, so he has granted the Son to have life in him. And he has given him authority to judge, because he is the Son of Man. Friends, we don't know the lesson. This is the word of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen.
In his hands, I will not believe.
the words of Thomas, the disciple of our Lord Jesus Christ. The words of Thomas, uttered to his fellow disciples shortly after the resurrection of our Lord. Words that have fairly or unfairly earned Thomas the nickname or the alias of Doubting Thomas, because he did not believe that our Lord Jesus Christ had been resurrected. But I would like to suggest that if you had been there at that time, under those circumstances, that you would not have been said anything else other than what Thomas said. Let me ask a question. Do you believe in nothing? Have you ever seen a ghost? There are some people who say they do not believe in ghosts. They have no time for foolishness because once you're dead, you're done dead and your bones turn to whistles and that is the end of you.
Why, what?
And that is perhaps the same feeling which informed Thomas's words when he had heard that our Lord had been seen. Thomas said that is nonsense. You do not come back from the dead. Thomas would have been there on the Good Friday. He would perhaps have seen our Lord taken from the cross and put in the sepulchre. He would have seen how the soldier had pierced his side and blood and water came out. He would have seen the lifeless form of our Lord being ministered unto by those who were there and there. Thomas perhaps even might have helped them put him in the sepulchre. And so now you are going to come and tell me that this same lifeless form I have seen, this same body that I have to live, this same person whom we love, but now we know it's dead, you are going to come and tell me that you have seen him. I got first to touch. I got first to feel. I got first to feel. And then maybe, perhaps I will believe. Now what's wrong with that? As I have said so many times, if someone were to tell you that your great aunt Daisy or your grandmother whom you attended the funeral some years ago was seen walking down Broad Street, you wouldn't believe it either. You would tell a fella you got the wrong man. You got the wrong woman. That could not be my grandmother or my great aunt Daisy. Simply because within our understanding, within our ken, within our experience, the dead does not come back. And so even though we might with a certain amount of sarcasm perhaps, a certain amount of derision refer to Thomas as Doubting Thomas, we know in our heart of hearts that if we had been there, we would have said the same thing. You know, I believe that people come back. I believe very strongly that there is life after this life. And not only because of what I have read in the Bible, or the promises I have read in the Bible, or the words of our Lord, but because of my own experiences, because of the experiences of other persons whom I have read and I have heard. I like to tell the story, not a story, a word of fact, of how many years ago when my wife and I were first married, we lived in a house which was haunted. There was no doubt about it. We saw things that were not supposed to be, like a man walking his dog at 2 o'clock in the morning across the lawn where nobody was supposed to be. We saw things, we felt things like arms around our waist, and there was nobody there. We heard people call our names, and there was nobody in the room. And so therefore, from personal experience, there must be some kind of movement, of action, of life after life. But not only that, brothers and sisters in Christ, not only that, we have ourselves the promise of our Lord Jesus Christ, who said, in order for me to come again, first I must go. He promised his disciples, he promised the world, that there is life after life. In my Father's house, he said, there are many rooms, and I go to prepare a place for you, if it were not so, would I have told you. And so it is on occasions like these, when we come, when we gather together, to say our I would not even say our final farewell, because it is not last, but to pay our last respects on this side of the world. For that is what it is, to offer our respects, to offer our words of thanksgiving and our words of respect for one whom we have known, and our presence in support of those who are mourning. It is on occasions like these that we come to remind ourselves that this is not the end of the road, but rather it is the beginning of something new for those who have passed on. You see, my brothers and sisters in Christ, a man, a human being, a woman, is made up of body and soul. It is the body that we know of, and the soul that we experience and we hear of. It is the body which is that which is most tangible, but it is the soul which lives on after the body has died. And so because we are a body and soul, we can live and we can exist in two different dimensions. It is like a fish or a mammal, rather. A mammal can live in water and also experience life on land to a lesser or greater degree. And so it is we human beings. Because we are creatures made in the image of God, we have the option, we have the authority, we have the possibility, but we can live also here as well as there. And so today we come to give thanks to Almighty God for the life of our sister Carl. We come, yes, many of us with heavy hearts and grieving thoughts, but we come nevertheless to thank God for what she was to us, for the experience which we share, in the knowledge and the understanding that none of us are perfect, for we have all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. There is none of us, not one of us, who can claim to be perfect. So when we look at the life of our sister Carmen, we cannot see perfection. Indeed, if we see perfection, she could not die. She would be as God. But we come to thank God for what she was, for the times we shared, for the good things that he gave her, and for the good things that she shared among us. We come to thank God in the song Faith and Belief that there is life after this. That death is only a transition from one state of being to the other state of existence. From being in the body to being in the spirit. But she has made the transition and crossed the path, crossed the border from life in the body to life in the spirit. But that, even though that thought comforts us, that is not enough for us merely to be comforted by those thoughts. But we must remember that the good book tells us that it comes to what every man wants, death and then the judgment. There will come that time when we have to face Almighty God as the Queen says he has come to die the thick and the dead. The time will come when we will have to face God, to face judgment, to face the Almighty, and to make an account of our scripture. And our challenge today is to examine ourselves, not to think of what our sister has done or what she has left undone, not to dwell on the sins she has committed or the sins that she is purported to have committed, but rather to face ourselves where we are at this point in life and to make an assessment of where we are going and what we want out of the rest of our lives. For my brothers and sisters in Christ, the Bible tells us, but if the strong man knew when the thief was coming, he would secure his house. The Bible tells us that two will be in the field and one will be taken and the other one will be left. The Bible tells us that we know neither the time nor the hour when the Son of Man will come, or when he will require of us to come to him. There are many of us who behave as though we make ourselves. We live as though we made ourselves. We are some of the most difficult people to live with. We are the most stubborn people to get on with. We stand in a position and we take a firm position and we will not move from it regardless of. We neither make friends nor are we friendly. We are not nice people to know because we believe that we do not have to respect, to care, or to love anybody else. But the time will come, brothers and sisters in Christ. Indeed, the time may be for each and every
I was a boy growing up, it seemed to me as though only old people died. And as I got into my 40s and my 50s, I began to realize that it seemed to me as though young people are dying as fast as their older ones. For all variety of reasons, whether it is accident, or AIDS, or heart attacks, or stress, or drugs, or whatever it is, the younger people have almost as high a mortality rate in this country as the older people. On Tuesday of this week, a family will be laid to rest, a young man whom I have known for some time, because he went to school with my son. He was the head boy at his school. He was a young man, well thought of, who had seemingly a good future. He was, to all intents and purposes, in good health. And it seemed as though he was on the brink of a life of promise when suddenly he died at 17 years old. Death is not a respecter of persons. Death is not something that will come to one and not the other. It will come to everyone. And so my message and my challenge to you who are here this evening is this. Is your life good? Are you at peace with yourself and with others? We cannot do anything more for our sister Carmen except to pray for her. For the last page has been written. For the last full stop has been put in place and the book has been closed. But we still have an opportunity. We still have an opportunity to make amends for that quarrel that has been dragged out for all these years. For the fact that we are not speaking to that person or this person. For the fact that we are holding somebody in our minds today or tomorrow or the last 2 weeks or 2 years for what they have done or not done or what we imagine that they have not done. And as we die tonight, we shall go to our grave with that burden in our hearts. We thank God for the life of us. My first knowledge of carving was the year which I came to this church almost 10 years ago. We had every October bank holiday, we had a walking race. And at that time, she must have been into her 80s. And I met Carmen on the track, as it were, walking up Worthen Road with her two pumps, her shorts, and her t-shirt. And believe me, Carmen was setting a pace that was off from all of the women and some of the men. And consistently over a period of time, she brought back the prize for the oldest competitor and the winner in her age race. It was only after she became increasingly frail that she was unable to compete. But her spirit was always there, for she would say to me, if only I still had strength in my legs, I would come and join the race. So she was a woman who was not afraid, brothers and sisters, of physical exercise. She was not afraid of competition. And indeed, we could see that she was not afraid to travel the world. But more than that, I know her as someone who was generous to those whom she wanted to be generous. I know her as someone who was not afraid to offer what she had. I know her as someone who was willing to share what she had. And so because of all these things, we thank God for what he has given her. And even more, those that we do not know about, we thank God for all these things. We pray God will have mercy on her soul. For you know, my brothers and sisters in Christ, regardless of what we may think or what we may believe, each one of us have an opportunity and a chance in this life to live a proper life. For we have been made and created in the image of God. According to the Bible, according to Genesis, we were made and created in the image of God. Therefore, it is up to us to maintain that image or to allow it to slip and to become the image of the devil. What you are and what you will become is determined only by what you want to be. So, brothers and sisters, we commend our sister to Almighty God. We pray that he will have mercy on her soul, even as though we pray that he will have mercy on our soul when our time comes to depart this world. But we do it with the knowledge and the understanding. But after this life, there is life to come. Life in the Spirit, life in you, life in the mere presence of Almighty God, where there is no longer old age or frailty, where there is no longer insanity, where there is no longer loss of living, but there is rejoicing. The mere presence of Almighty God in the age of God. Rest eternal God and to her, O Lord. May she and all the saints rest in peace and Christ in glory.
Amen. We shall stand and sing the hymn.
Thank you.
ever end. Party. Let us pray with confidence in God our Father, who raised our Lord Jesus Christ from the dead, for the salvation of all. Grant, Lord, that your servant Aaron may know the fullness of life, which you have promised to those who love you. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
We close with those who mourn, especially the Lord's family of Aaron. Increase their faith in your undying love. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
May we be strengthened in our faith, live the rest of our lives in fellowship with your Son, Jesus Christ, and be ready to make you call us to the fullness of life. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Show your mercy, O God, to the dying. Strengthen them with hope and fill them with the peace and joy of your presence. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
We commend all people to your unfailing love, that in them your will may be fulfilled, and we rejoice at the faithful witness of your saints in every age, praying that we may share with them in your eternal kingdom. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray. Merciful Father, and Lord of all lives, we praise you that men are made in your image and reflect your truth and light. We thank you for the life of your servant Karen, for the love and mercy she received from you and showed among us. Above all, we rejoice at your gracious promise to all your servants, living and departed, that we shall rise again at the coming of Jesus Christ. And we ask that in due time we may share with our sister Karen that clearer vision when we shall see you face to face in the same Christ, our Lord. Amen. Let us pray and we pray for the family of the family. Thank you, O Lord, to all who are believing the spirit of faith and courage, that they may have strength to meet the days to come with steadfastness and patience, not sorrowing as those without hope, but in thankful remembrance of your great goodness, and in the joyful expectation of eternal life with those they love and see no longer. And this we ask in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Pray, Almighty and ever-living God, you are always more ready to hear than we to pray, and to give more than we either desire or deserve. Pour upon us the abundance of your mercy, forgiving us those things of which our conscience is afraid, and giving us those good things for which we are not worthy to ask, except through the merits and mediation of Jesus Christ our Savior, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Shall we say the grace together? The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all now and forever. I would like to take this opportunity on behalf of the rector, his wife, his family, the Corona Church Council, and all the members here of the Fellowship, the mothers are here, the men's fellowship, the Hill, the choir here, the organist, the director of music, all of us here, and we would like to extend to all of her close family and relatives, especially her daughter, who is a member of our choir. We'd like to give them our sincerest condolences. pray that God will receive her into his arms of mercy and grant her the spiritual refreshment which await those who die in his fear and love. Rest eternal grant unto her, O Lord, and thy perpetual shine upon her. May she rest in peace.
Him and can be that I should gain an interest in the Savior's plan.
Thank you.
and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. I heard a voice from heaven saying, write this. Happy are the dead who die in the face of Christ. Henceforth, says the Spirit, they may rest from their labors, for they take with them the record of their deeds. A man born of a woman has but a short time to live. Like a flower, he blossoms eventually. Like a shadow, he flees and never stays. In the midst of life, we are in death. To whom can we turn for help but to you, Lord, who are justly angered by our sins? Lord God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal, holy and most merciful Savior, deliver us from the bitter pains of the death. For you know the secrets of our hearts. In your mercy, hear our prayer. Forgive us our sins, and at our last hour, let us not fall away from you. Ensure and certain hope of resurrection to eternal life. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, we commend to Almighty God our sister Carmen, and we commit her body to the ground. Earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust. And we beseech you in your infinite goodness to give us grace to live in your dear love and to die in your favor. So when your well-beloved son shall come again in judgment, and both this our sister Carmen and we ourselves may be found acceptable in your sight. Grant this for the sake of your son, Jesus Christ, O Lord. Rest eternal grant unto her, O Lord. May she rest in peace and Christ in glory.
Thank you. Now and forevermore.
Amen.